Bom dia. One day I will be able to present in Portuguese. I'm trying to learn a bit. Anyway, so we are here to talk about, again, stability, wine stability. After the subject protein stability, we are here today to talk about tartaric stability. Proposing you our strategy that is a stabilizing strategy based on the use of stabilizing colloids. So I will organize my speech. I will divide this presentation on a few points. So I will start talking about tartaric instability just to introduce the subject. Then I will jump on two enemies that are crystals and colloids, focusing on, of course, some stabilizing colloids. Then I will propose you the main benefits you producers can take profit from using this strategy, so stabilizing strategy based on colloids. And I will finish talking about potassium polyaspartate, this new compound that now is available on the market. I will give you two examples of the application of this new stabilizing compound, talking about at the end, talking about Zenith. So let's start talking about tartaric instability, just to introduce the subject. What is it? Why we have to manage this thing? Why wines are tartarically unstable? In a very easy way, you see some pictures, but you know, it's common to say that wines are tartarically unstable from the chemistry. We could say because the product of the concentration is higher than the solubility product of what? Of two ions that are the bitartrate ion and the potassium. But how this thing is possible? So how is it possible that the product of the concentrations is higher than the solubility product? So the maximum amount of these compounds that can stay in solution. It's simple. This is possible because when we start fermenting juices, so when we start producing ethanol, we lower the solubility product of potassium bitartrate. So potassium bitartrate is a salt that is totally unsoluble in ethanol. So it's like to say when we start fermenting, we start building tartaric instability. This is what happened normally. So what we can do to manage this situation? We can, you see, there are two dishes here on the left. This is the picture that show the instability situation. So our task is find the way to balance these two dishes. So or we lower the weight of the product of the concentrations, so the dish we have on the left, or we increase the weight of the dish we have on the right. So we increase the solubility product. We are talking about strategies to achieve the tartaric stability of wines. So we must go in that situation. We must bottle wines that are in that situation. So how can we reach these new situations? So how can we reach the wine stability? Basically, there are two different ways. We can talk about subtractive techniques. So we take out something from the wine. So we lower the weight of the dish we have on the left. Or we increase the weight of the dish we have on the right. So we can talk about additive techniques. What I'm talking about? These techniques are a few. You can read here. Also, I tried to put some years when these techniques were approved, starting from, of course, the winter that has been always used. You can read on the left subtractive techniques. So these techniques a few years ago were, I would say, not specific techniques. So techniques that, and the cold is the typical example, techniques that are able to give us the tartaric stability, but taking out compounds in general. So this is a not specific approach. So we cannot take out only compounds that are not positive, so that are at the end or the bitartrate or potassium. With the cold, the typical example is when we take out potassium bitartrate, we take out a lot of colloids in general. So it's enough to taste a wine before and after the cold stability, and it's evident to taste the difference, no, between the two samples. Anyway, then these subtractive techniques became more specific, so electrodialysis, resins, but we have also additive techniques. No, you can read, so in the 70s, the metatartaric acid was approved, then manoproteins arrived, and CMC. Nowadays, luckily I'm here, because we can talk about as well potassium polyaspartate. It has been approved in October 2017, and this is a new important tool that it's available for all the producers nowadays on the market. So, going ahead, let's jump on the subject eternal rivals, so crystals and colloids. I'm going to show you some pictures. So, why crystals, and now I'm talking about potassium bitartrate, of course, it's an enemy of, or better, why colloids are enemies for crystals? Because colloids can interfere a lot with the crystal formation and growth. This is a good picture, I think, but because this is a picture that is able to show the proper capability of wines to start stabilizing themselves. So, what is it? We have compared here, you can read on the top, this is a cold test, so these are two samples that were submitted at, to the cold test, so -4 degrees during 6 days. On the right, we have a wine, that is, in this case, a Touriga Nacional. On the left, we have an hydroalcoholic solution with exactly the same analytical parameters. So, exactly the same pH, alcohol proof, potassium, tartaric acid, and delta microsiemens as well. After the cold test, you can see the amount of sediment. The wine is showing much less sediment compared to the hydroalcoholic solution. Why this thing is possible if the analytical parameters are the same? This is possible because the wine is not only a typical solution, it's also a colloidal solution. What is missing on the left is the colloidal solution. So colloids are able to start increasing the wine stability. And here, this wine, but in general wines, are able to show a direction. So wines are saying, we are able to stabilize a bit ourselves, taking profit from the colloidal amount we contain. So it's the indication of a direction. Now, of course, on the market there are colloids that are very efficient, that are very efficient in increasing the tartaric stability and very efficient in interfering with the life of crystals in general. I'm going to show you some pictures to describe the common situation we have in wines. So these are potassium bitartrate crystals. From the bibliography in books, it's very common to find this kind of pictures. In wines, you will never have this kind of crystals. So potassium bitartrate crystals with this shape. Why? Because these are lucky crystals. So I'm using this picture to give you the concept. These crystals are very lucky. They are like this tree that is growing on a very good soil, in very good conditions, with a very good weather, probably with the proper amount of water and so on. So the situation is very simple. But in wines, this situation is never present. So in wines, going ahead with the example of the tree, probably we have this. What is this? This is a bit less lucky tree that is trying to survive. It's trying to survive because is in presence of some different limiting factors. What does it mean this? Of course, here we have altitude, we have probably a low temperature, we have not enough water for sure, a lot of wind, so different limiting factors. And this, of course, tree, it's evident that has some problems. No? It's not so beautiful, okay? These limiting factors, coming back to wines, are colloids. We can take profit from different kind of colloids and use some different limiting factors to avoid the production of crystals. In wines, we have more or less this. These are potassium bitartrate crystals. You see that there is a dominant shape, but there are a lot of things inside. Then if we increase the magnification, we can understand more, but colloids can change a lot the typical shape of this potassium bitartrate crystal. So going ahead, what you have here, this is a new example. On the left, you have the typical shape, no, of potassium bitartrate. On the right, you have a new shape that is the same, exactly the same crystal. So we are talking about potassium bitartrate, but this crystal was produced in a wine, Primitivo wine is a red Italian variety, treated with CMC and Everett Gamma Arabic. You see that the shape is totally different. Why? Because this crystal was not able to grow normally. And this crystal was present into the wine because by purpose we used a dosage that was not enough to give the full stability to the wine. Increasing the dosage of these two compounds, this crystal, of course, has been not able to be present. Anyway, so very different shape because of the presence of specific stabilizing colloids. If we go ahead, because, you know, potassium bitartrate in wines are very different. I started working in this field now a few years ago, and it was very common to look with the microscope at some samples and compare what we were able to see in the microscope with some reference images, no? And say, okay, we have potassium bitartrate, no, this is a different crystal, this is calcium tartrate, no, this is something else. This approach was very improper, and it's enough to take a look here. What is this? This seems to be something totally different. We are talking about potassium bitartrate. Why this so different shape? This is the art of nature, because in this wine, the typical colloidal solution and the presence of Everett Gamma Arabic and the Seyal Gamma Arabic together were changing the shape in this way. These crystals were trying to grow, producing layers and increasing the magnification. Here we are at 800 magnification. We see in a very good way that these crystals are composed by layers. You cannot find on bibliography these kind of pictures because these are informations that are very new. I mean, these are crystals with a not typical shape at all. Anyway, so here we have produced only problems during the growth. But we can also, you see in this new picture, increasing the magnification. So we are here at 2000. What is this? This is the beginning of the growth of a potassium bitartrate crystal. This crystal is again trying to be present into the wine, producing some layers. And we were able, luckily, to pick the birth of a crystal, that is this image, that is this, I think that is very beautiful. You see these tips, no? These are crystals that are going to be produced. Of course, I'm showing you crystals, I'm showing you images that underline the effect on the growth of stabilizing compounds, stabilizing colloids. If these stabilizing colloids are used with a proper dosage, these crystals cannot be produced. So the birth and the growth more of these crystals is stopped completely. Now, this is exactly what I'm saying. So this was a Chardonnay with a delta micro Siemens that is close to 100. This is a medium high instability level. Treating this wine with carboxymethyl cellulose, we were able to achieve 24. Wines with delta micro Siemens lower than 30 are wines that we have to consider as stable. So from a medium high instability level to a wine that is fully stable, using a proper dosage of CMC. Okay, now I want to underline some main benefits of this strategy that is based on the use of stabilizing colloids. So I have to say that the reference method to achieve the tartaric stability is unluckily still the cold stabilization. No? Worldwide is still the reference method. I'm saying unluckily because this method, this approach has got a lot of points of weakness. The cold is a subtractive, we have seen, not specific technique. We take out important colloids. We lose quality. It's expensive, for sure. And it has got also an important environmental impact. Going to the stabilization strategy based on colloids, it's an additive technique. So we don't take out things that are an important part of the quality of the wine. We can reach in this way a very high quality level. The cost is always lower than the cold. If you check deeply in details this fact, you will see that the cost is much more competitive than the one you have with the cold. And of course, consequently, the environmental impact is also lower. I want to give you some more data about the cost and the environmental impact now. So if we compare in a very general way the costs of different stabilizing strategies, you see here, starting from the potassium polyaspartate, this is, okay, the raw material we use during the production, but gamma arabic, mannoprotein, CMC, metatartaric acid, these colloids, also mannoproteins, are cheaper than the cold. This is the cost per 100 hectoliters. Mannoproteins are, of course, expensive, but when producers use mannoproteins, don't want only to stabilize. The goal is also to have a specific sensory effect. So it's a bit different story. Anyway, labor is also cost. So if we consider the stabilizing colloids strategy, we need less hours of work, of labor, compared to the cold. Jumping on the sustainability subject, I'm starting from the amount of water used using these different techniques. So you see that we don't waste water, of course, adding stabilizing colloids. Here is evident that electrolysis can have a very important impact on the potable water used. These numbers show the number of liters per hectoliter. At the end, it's a percentage, okay? So the number of liters of potable water you have to use per hectoliter of wine treated. It's also possible to use electrodialysis nowadays in a much more efficient way, because electrodialysis that are combined with the reversal osmosis can use approximately from 5 to 10 liters per hectoliter of water, but the impact is still important. And underlining the amount of carbon dioxide produced per hectoliter using these different techniques, I don't want to enter in details, but I want to underline that the cold treatment is for sure the most impactant. You see here, with the cold, it's common to produce 1.4 kilos of CO2 equivalent per hectoliter of wine stabilized. So this is an important impact. Now, I will jump on the potassium polyaspartate subject. So finally we have it, and why we consider this compound so attractive, why we consider this new molecule an important tool for all the producers. What we request to stabilizing products, so to be effective and efficient as well, to maintain the effect during time. And here you can see the comparison between the metatartaric carboxymethyl cellulose and an hydrolyzed Seyal gamma arabic, mannoproteins, and the new compound, potassium polyaspartate. So considering the efficacy, but I would say effectiveness, potassium polyaspartate is comparable to CMC and metatartaric acid. We'll see later on that it's a bit more efficient than CMC. If we consider the effect during time, you see that is also very good. Potassium polyaspartate is able to maintain the stability during time. And nowadays we can say through years, because we started trialing with potassium polyaspartate in 2011, and wines that were treated in 2011 are still stable. But we don't request only these two characteristics, because when we have to use these compounds must be also easy to be used. So what about the filterability? The filterability is also important, and you see that potassium polyaspartate is very filterable. It's very easy to be used. Last but absolutely not least, the effect on color. We don't have any negative effect on color if we consider metatartaric, gamma arabic, mannoproteins, and potassium polyaspartate. It's well known that CMC has got a limit. If you treat red wines with CMC alone, you will lose a certain amount of color. So at the end, the characteristics of this new compound are very interesting. I want to enter a bit more in details. We were talking about efficacy effectiveness. So let's see together how efficient is this compound. These are trials we did with potassium polyaspartate on different wines. You see two white wines and two reds, comparing what potassium polyaspartate with carboxymethylcellulose and metatartaric acid. Starting from different levels of instability, the histograms that are over this red line say that the wines are unstable. Okay, so below, under this line, all the wines are now stable. You see that potassium polyaspartate is efficient, I would say a bit more than CMC, comparable to the metatartaric. Going ahead. Is efficient like the metatartaric. Okay, but okay, now, so why this potassium polyaspartate is interesting? We have the metatartaric. No, you all know the limit of the metatartaric, that is the capability to maintain the stability during time. We stressed here a wine treated with metatartaric and potassium polyaspartate in two different samples, of course. After 2 days of heat treatment at 40 degrees, 2 days, sorry, 14 days of heat treatment at 40 degrees, this is, I call this test a stress test. It's evident to notice that the sample that was treated with metatartaric has lost the stability. And it's even a bit more unstable than the control, because of course, after the hydrolysis of the metatartaric acid, we release tartaric. Having more tartaric, we increase the instability level. Here is evident that after this stress test, the sample treated with potassium polyaspartate was perfectly stable. So potassium polyaspartate is very resistant. And here we have some more evidences, but these are only after 1 year. This is a wine treated with potassium polyaspartate in comparison with the metatartaric, same wine, so treated with polyaspartate and metatartaric acid. After, I would say, let's consider only the 12 months. After 12 months, the metatartaric has lost the full stabilizing effect. Polyaspartate is maintaining, I would say perfectly maintaining, the stability level. Polyaspartate is easy to be used. So if we consider the filterability, we are talking about compounds that can be considered colloids. So the reality is that this is a polymer, this potassium polyaspartate is a polymer, but is not a so big polymer because the molecular weight is around 5,000. So it's a quite short polymer, and because of this, is very easy to be used. Translated, is very filterable. You see here two lines, but at the end we have only one because we have one over the other. The control and the same wine added with 10 grams per hectoliter of potassium polyaspartate have the same filterability behavior. So potassium polyaspartate is very filterable. Now, we were touching the point interaction with the color. This is the a way to estimate the color loss, checking the optical density at 520. Comparing three samples, so same wine, it was a Sangiovese, treated with metatartaric, carboxymethylcellulose, and potassium polyaspartate. It's evident to notice this. So CMC alone cause the color loss. potassium polyaspartate, not. It's like the metatartaric. In some cases, is able to react with the color much less than the metatartaric. So this is one more point of strength. This is a lucky compound. This is a very lucky compound in winemaking. Now, I will show you two last examples of application of potassium polyaspartate. So I'm going to talk about the zenith range, but just to say that this zenith range is a range of products we have developed during the last few years, all based on potassium polyaspartate. The heart of these products is potassium polyaspartate. And starting from the application of the most simple, this is a solution, a 10% solution of potassium polyaspartate. The name is Zenituno. You can see here that starting from a white wine, Albarino, with a high instability level, because this was 100, around 200, this is a very high instability level, we have a perfectly stable wine. So this potassium polyaspartate is very, very efficient. A second example of application of a different product, this is a solution of potassium polyaspartate and Varec, filterable Varec Gamma Arabic, blended together in the product. I'm talking about Zenith Color. So this is the application of this Zenith Color, starting from a Tempranillo. This was mainly tartarically unstable, but with also a quite good amount of unstable color that then it was also destabilized because of the high tartaric instability level. Starting from this situation, you see the amount of sediment, we have this. So we have a wine that is perfectly stable. So jumping from a high instability, highly unstable situation to a very good stability level, only using a specific product. So only adding a specific product. So this is, of course, a very good opportunity from 90 to 28 Delta Microsiemens. I close this presentation saying that we are sure that this strategy, this stabilizing strategy that is based on colloids, is able to give more competitiveness to all the producers. But this competitiveness is achieved going in the proper direction. So keeping in consideration, focusing on the quality of what you are going to produce, and also, of course, thinking about the sustainability. Nowadays, we are able to propose you a new important tool, that is this new compound. We have a full range of products, is Zenith. I think that this Zenith is going to represent an important opportunity for all the wine producers. So I finished, so molto obrigado. We are here the full day, so just in case of interests or questions, we are there available to share with you a lot of information. Yes, please.
In the slide you had that you're comparing the wine after 5 months and 12 months.
Yes.
The graphic with the treatment with the MTA after 12 months.
We can come back.
No.
This one.
Yes.
If you see here, this is the drop in tartaric acid. Now, this wine that was the control, so not stabilized, was losing tartaric during time. So this wine was losing tartaric. So here, it's We did this test on a few bottles, but you see here that I understand your question. So why this is more stable? No, it's not more stable. This is a sample that has lost this amount. So starting from here, has lost this amount of tartaric. So it's a matter of, we are talking about very small differences. It's a matter of the average conditions between samples. But don't consider this delta. Consider the meaning of, these samples. So we are talking about unstable samples with proper levels, okay? We go in a completely different situation, so very stable wines during time and wines that change the stability during time, so become, during time, more unstable. This is, I would say this is a sort of, I would say, analytical difference between samples. But for, I mean, focus on the concept, on the concept that there is behind the trial. You are talking about this one? No, but we were talking about the difference between this. No, no, but this is the same wine. Here we are talking about the same wine during time, and here we have, after 12 months, the green line, after 12 months, we have the, let's say, instability level of the sample treated with the metatartaric. Of course, this is over this because of the hydrolysis, of course, yeah.
Vous n'avez pas parlé de la stabilité du bitartrate de calcium.
Who is speaking, sorry? Ah, yes.
What about the stability of bitartrate de calcium?
This is a very good question. Very difficult question as well. So the question is, what about the calcium tartrate stability? It's a task that is still open because we cannot manage the calcium tartrate instability using these colloids. Also, potassium bitartrate cannot stabilize calcium tartrate. Why? Not because it's not able to stabilize this specific salt, but because of the wine conditions. Just to let you understand the situation, so in a common wine, I would say averagely, we have, I would consider, around 1 gram per liter of potassium, more or less, and 100 ppm of calcium. We hope less, we hope. But the ratio is like, I would say, averagely 10 to 1. That's why these stabilizing compounds are saturated by potassium and cannot work on calcium. This is, unluckily, the wine situation. If we have, but it's not possible, but if we have a wine with a much lower level of potassium and a high amount of calcium, this potassium polyaspartate is very efficient also in blocking the stabilizing the calcium tartrate. But it's not the condition we have. So unluckily, the calcium tartrate instability is still an open challenge.